means for the top quark Monte Carlo mass scheme. So this is work together with André Hoang and Simon Betzer. And the main part of this talk is based on this publication here. So if you want to have more details, you can read it up there, or better, just ask me. But in the end, I will also talk about the new ongoing project about the hadronization model. So what will I talk about? As you might know, parton showers are an essential part of every Monte Carlo event generator. And Monte Carlo event generators are essentially essential for basically almost all phenomenological studies at hadron colliders. So the parton shower is that part of the event generator that simulates the consecutive branching and splitting of quarks and gluons at a perturbative scale that is then terminated at some low infrared scale that we call the shower cutoff, where then this partonic event is handed over to the hadronization model. So why is this important for top quark mass? This is because the most precise top quark mass measurements nowadays at hadron colliders are based on direct reconstruction methods. This is sketched here. This means that you identify all the top quark decay products, so here the B quark jet, and the decay products of the W boson that can be hadronically or leptonically. So you reconstruct this final state, and you can take the invariant mass, and of course this is very sensitive to the top quark mass here. So here are the most recent results from hadron colliders, from ATLAS, CMS, and Tevatron, and you see that nowadays with these methods they reach a precision of around like half a GeV. But the problem with this is that to have a theoretical prediction that you can use to then fit for this mass parameter, you need to simulate this complicated final state, and for this you rely on Monte Carlo event generators. So what we are actually measuring in these measurements is just this parameter of the top quark mass in this event generator. And now it's not so clear how this parameter in this event generator can be related to a well-defined field theoretical mass scheme, like, for example, the pole mass. And since we know that this shower cutoff has an impact on the infrared behavior of these parton showers, we can now ask the question, what does this mean for this mass scheme of the top quark that is extracted in these type of measurements? So why is that a non-trivial issue? So as you all know, the top quark is a particle that carries color charge, so you cannot really think of a freely propagating top quark. It's not that simple. So this mass parameter m top in this type of calculations is always just a scheme-dependent parameter in a perturbative calculation. And so you have to ask the question, which scheme is this Monte Carlo using when it does the calculation? So this relation of this, what we call this Monte Carlo mass parameter, m top Monte Carlo, and any field theoretically well-defined mass scheme, let's take, for example, the pole mass, can in principle get contributions from different parts. So it can in principle get perturbative contributions to this relation that are coming from the parton shower, which is the perturbative part of the event generator. In principle, there can be additional non-perturbative contributions coming from the hadronization model, and there could also be other contributions coming from anything that depends on how the Monte Carlo is modeling things like color reconnection, how finite width effects are included or not included, and all these type of things. So the main part of my talk will be on the perturbative side, so talking about the parton shower. And in the end, I will talk, will give you an outlook of, on some ongoing project we're doing on the hadronization models to identify these possible non-perturbative contributions. So let me quickly mention some previous work that has been done on this issue. So these guys, a few years ago, they did what they called the Monte Carlo top mass calibration. So what they did is they had very accurate predictions for this observable two jettiness in E plus E minus collisions, where they had full control over the mass scheme and analytic calculations, and then compared this to some runs with the Pythia event generator, and in this way they could find a numerical relation between this Monte Carlo mass parameter and a well-defined mass scheme. These are the results. One has to say that the universality of this procedure is conjectured but not proven, so this means this was done for E plus E minus, for two jettiness in E plus E minus. It's not really proven that you can then use the same results also for other processes and other observables. And another thing is that these calibration studies, they are very nice because they really give you a number as an answer, but on the other hand, this is not so good because they just give you a number as an answer. And you cannot really disentangle these different contributions. You cannot understand where which contribution is coming from. And this is what our project is aiming at, that we want to conceptually understand the different contributions that we want to get a handle on these things. So this is our project. I would like to quickly mention that in this old business of these top quark mass measurements at hadron colliders, there are recently many studies going on, so just a selection of work where people are looking, for example, at different way of how to include next leading order information, or here people looked at the effects of finite width effects comparing to using narrow width approximations. So just to say that people are looking at many things in this business, but our project is the effect of the parton shower cutoff on the top quark mass. So, as I said, we want to examine the properties of the parton showers with respect to the dependence on the shower cutoff that we call Q0. And because any real parton shower, as it's implemented in an event generator, always needs this shower cutoff to avoid to run into into infrared singularity, so to produce infinitely many partons, at some point you have to stop your perturbative branching. And so we want to understand the mass of the top quark state that is produced in these hard interactions. So this is the first restriction that we have in our setup, that we do not address any issues related to top quark decay. So we are choosing an observable that is not sensitive to top quark decay. Then we adopt an error-width approximation, as it's actually used in any state-of-the-art Monte Carlo nowadays, so we do not address any finite lifetime, any finite width effects. This is the second restriction we have in our setup. And I also have to mention that parton showers are actually conceptually valid only for boosted top quarks in a quasi-collinear limit. So this is a third restriction that we have, that we only look at boosted tops. And then we can ask the question, what is the effect of the shower cutoff on this generator mass scheme? So how are we tackling this problem? So we are studying the coherent branching formalism, which is the basis of the Herwig 7 angular order parton shower. So this parton shower, the standard parton shower of the Herwig 7 event generator, basically is this coherent branching algorithm. We are implementing this shower cut as it is implemented there, which is a cut on the transverse momentum. So any splitting of transverse momentum smaller than the shower cutoff is vetoed. We use the observable to jettiness in the plus and minus collisions for boosted tops to study this, because this is an observable, this is like an event shape that tells you how jet-like an event is. This is something that we can understand very well analytically. So I will just say, I will call this observable tau, sometimes I will call it thrust, sometimes to jettiness. I will use these words interchangeably, even though they're not exactly the same for massive quarks, but never mind. So this process, this observable, can be calculated analytically in a QCD factorization theorem based on effective field theories, soft linear effective theory and boosted heavy quark effective theory, and can also be calculated analytically in this parton shower algorithm, in this coherent branching formalism. Since we only want to study the perturbative effects in the parton shower, we don't want to be sensitive to anything going on in the hadronization model that we do not understand yet. So we model hadronization in a very simple way. This is actually also what Chris Lee told us yesterday in his talk, that for these event shapes, you can model hadronization very well by just convoluting your partonic distribution with a non-perturbative model function in this way to get the full hadronic distribution. So in this way, we have full control over what's going on in the hadronization. So, sorry, this slide is a bit full, but don't worry, not everything is important. So what our first step? We want to understand how we can relate this coherent branching formalism to analytic QCD calculations. So in this QCD factorization theorem, based on these effective field theories, you can derive a factorization theorem that has this form. So there are different hard functions that describe the hard interaction in the process. This is not so important for us. Important is that we have a soft function that describes the large angle soft radiation that is in this process, here in orange. And we have a so-called jet function that describes the ultracollinear radiation. Ultracollinear radiation, these radiation of gluons that are soft in a top rest frame, and in the left frame, they are boosted along with the top. This radiation is described by this jet function here in blue. Then you have this different type of evolution functions, these U's here. These are just the functions that take one function at one renormalization scheme to another renormalization scheme. In this process, the logarithms are resummed and so on. This is not so important. Important is that the mass scheme in this calculation is fully fixed in this jet function. So here you can define which renormalization scheme you're using for your mass, and you have full control over that. Now we can look at this coherent branching, so at this parton shower algorithm. For this two jettiness observable, actually there exists an analytic solution, which was done already some years ago. Usually it's written in Laplace space. It takes this form. Again, it's not so important the exact form, how it looks like. The important thing is that when you expand this to next to leading log accuracy, so we throw everything away that's higher order in the log counting, you can bring it to this form. You'll find these evolution kernels that are exactly the same that we find here in the QCD factorization theorem. So we can see that to next to leading log accuracy, these two things are actually analytically equivalent. So this is the first step that is important. Another important step is that I told you that here we have full control over the mass scheme. So we can really see that coherent branching without the shower cutoffs, everything here is just in a limit with zero shower cut, we can conclude that coherent branching and this QCD factorization theorem are equivalent at next to the log precision, and that the mass scheme that is effectively implemented in this coherent branching algorithm is really the pole mass. So this is the first important step that we can understand this. So now you can ask, okay, I showed you that we have next to the log precision. Is this actually enough to describe the peak region, because we have the most mass sensitivity in the peak region of the distribution, with full next to leading order precision? because this is not so clear, because when you look at this, when you expand the cross-section, this is a singular part of the cross-section to next to leading order, you get a term that is corresponds to the leading log tower, you get a term that corresponds to the next leading log tower, and you get some term that's actually already higher in the logarithmic counting. So this coherent branching algorithm will give you those two terms correctly, it will not reproduce this term correctly. Now you can ask, but how can you define a mask scheme in next leading order if you don't even get all next leading order terms correctly? And the answer is you can still do that, because we only want to be sensitive to the peak of the distribution, and when you define the peak of this distribution like this, you can do the math, it's quite simple, that you see when you expand this out to next leading order, then this blue term completely drops out from this equation. So when you just want to define the peak position, you just need the red terms that are fully included in the Parton shower. So it's sufficient next leading log position to define the peak position at next leading order. This is all we want to define our mass scheme. So we can conclude that the mass scheme of coherent branching without a cutoff really is the pole mass. This is the first step. What I just said here, that you don't need these extra blue terms, these extra next leading order terms, you can also see from these plots. So what you see here, these different bundles of purges, they correspond to runs with different shower cutoffs, where you see that you get a shift. This is all what I will talk about later. These different colors correspond to different Parton shower matching schemes. So the red color is just the standard Parton shower without any additional matching. This is just the next leading log accuracy. And this blue and green are then these Parton showers matched with this additional fixed order next to leading order information. And you see that actually in the peak you don't see anything. So these three curves, these three different colors are always exactly on top of each other. So this additional next to leading order matching just gives some effect somewhere here in the peak where it's not shown. This is just again to show again we don't need this next leading order matching in order to have next leading order precision on the peak. Tau is this two-jettiness observable. You look, two-jettiness is an event shape that tells you like how jet-like an event is, and this is our observable that we are always looking at. It's in the peak, it's similar to the mass in the two hemispheres. You can also think of it like this. Tau of zero means two pencil-like jets, and tau to one means spherical. Yes. Sorry? So now we can look at the effect when we include the shower cut, because any real Parton shower always needs to implement the shower cutoff. So I will give you the results, the finding of our studies first, summarized on this slide, and then we will look into more details how we can derive that. So the result of this shower, implementing this shower cut, is that when you calculate, for example, this on-shell self-energy diagrams that give you the pole of your propagator, you find that by implementing this shower cut, you're shifting the pole of your propagator. And this means that you're also shifting the definition of your mass scheme. So now the mass that you're effectively implementing then is not anymore the pole mass, but is this mass scheme, this cutoff-dependent mass scheme that we call the coherent branching mass. This is still located at the pole of the propagator, like the pole mass, just that now with this cutoff, the pole of the propagator is in a different position, so it's a different mass scheme. This is when you calculate these on-shell self-energy diagrams. When you implement this cutoff in all these other parts of the calculation on the ultracollinear radiation function, you find exactly this type of terms generated that you need to understand really that this is a change of your mass scheme. So let me explain what I mean. When you have your cross-section expressed in one mass scheme, you want to express it in another mass scheme, then you get these additional terms with these derivatives. This is just basically an expansion in the difference of the two mass schemes. And when you do the calculation with this cutoff, you find exactly these type of terms that correspond to changing the mass from the pole mass to this coherent branching mass. So we can really see that we are effectively changing the mass scheme by implementing the shower cut. I would like to quickly mention that this coherent branching mass scheme is a short distance mass. So it's free of the pole mass infrared renormalon. This means that in this series that is going on here, there is no renormalon hidden. So I will not go into details, but this we also showed in our paper. So when you implement a shower cut, you're not only cutting away some part of the ultracollinear radiation, which is changing your mass scheme, you're also cutting away some part of the large angle soft radiation. So you also have an effect there. But this is not tied to changing the mass scheme in any way. This just corresponds to effects that are directly related to how your hadronization model has to be changed after retuning. So when you change your cutoff, you basically have to then change your hadronization model accordingly such that the physical prediction does not change, because the physical prediction cannot depend on an unphysical scale like the cutoff. So all these conclusions that are presented here, we calculated explicitly in this framework of the analytic QCD factorization theorem and in the coherent branching algorithm, so we can directly compare these two approaches and we find perfect agreement. And then we can also numerically compare this directly to the real, to the Herwig 7 event generator, so to the real thing that is used. So how did we do this? So if we implement this shower cutoff intercoherent branching algorithm, we can still do the calculation analytically. So we just keep terms that are linear in Q0 and the mass and next leading order in alpha s. And with this type of expansions, you can solve this formula for this coherent branching algorithm still analytically, even in the presence of this cutoff. And then you can just compare the distribution with and without the cutoff, and you can see the effect of implementing the shower cut. And what we find is that the distribution with this shower cut can be, to this leading order, can be written as the distribution without the shower cut, but just shifted by this amount. And we can disentangle where these different contributions come from which parts of phase space. We can see that we get a contribution coming from soft radiation, and we can get a contribution coming from cutting away some of the ultracollinear radiation that has this additional mass dependence here. So this is an analytic result that we find for the coherent branching algorithm when implementing this cutoff. Now we can see how this looks in this QCD factorization theorem where we had this jet, this soft function. We can do the same thing here. We can implement this cutoff. So basically, just we're always working at one loop. So we just take your one loop Feynman diagrams and implement these conditions there. And then you have to do the calculation again. So again, we keep only terms that are linear in the cutoff. Then you can again solve this, all these integrals analytically. And we can see the effect of the shower cut. For example, on the soft function that is governing this large angle soft radiation, we see that the soft function with a shower cut can be written as the soft function without a shower cut times this derivative part. And you can also see that to this order that you can just absorb this actually into a shift of the soft function again with this coefficient. And this is exactly what is then tied to this amount of hedonization that you have to put into your hedonization model when you're cutting it away from your perturbative calculation. You can play the same game in this jet function, that is the function governing the ultracollinear radiation and where you have the sensitivity to your mass scheme. So when you calculate these off-shell contributions to this jet function, you again find something that the jet function with the cutoff is equivalent to the jet function without cutoff with this additional shifting term here. And this is exactly this term that I showed you before, this delta m. This is this term that tells you that you're shifting your mass from one scheme to another. This corresponds exactly to this type of terms that we find here. And when you calculate the on-shell self-energy diagrams that tell you the location of your pole in a propagator, we find exactly the shift in the opposite direction. This is exactly how it should be when you change your mass scheme. You're changing your mass scheme by this amount, and you get this scheme-changing terminal distribution like this. This is exactly what you find when you do a change of a mass scheme. So this tells you that implementing this cutoff is really changing your mass scheme from the pole mass to this coherent branching mass defined in this way. So this is what we find in the QCD factorization theorem. And we can now compare this to our findings that we had in the coherent branching formalism. So I told you, when we implement a cutoff in order to leave our physical prediction unchanged, we have to change our hedonization model in the same way to compensate for this shift. And we have to change our mass scheme in this way to compensate for this shift in order that the physical prediction is not sensitive to a change in the cutoff. If we now change the cutoff and do not do this thing, so we do not retune our hedonization model and we do not change our mass scheme, then we can really see a shift in the physical distribution when we shift our cutoff. And this is just given by this formula that the peak of the distribution is shifting by this amount where we get a coefficient coming from the soft function and a coefficient coming from the ultracollinear function, from the jet function. And these coefficients are exactly the same as the ones that I showed you two slides ago coming from the coherent branching algorithm. So we find perfect agreement here. So this type of evolution equation is called R-evolution. This tells you how the peak is shifting when you go from a cutoff Q0 prime to a cutoff Q0. And we can now compare our results, our prediction, how the peak should shift when we change the cutoff to an actual full Monte Carlo event generator to Herwig 7, because this has implemented this coherent branching algorithm as a pattern shower. So what are we doing now? We're using Herwig 7, running it for E plus E minus to TT bar with this type of angular ordered pattern shower, with some simplifications to make things a bit cleaner for us. For example, we're setting all the constituent quark masses, or in general, all light quark masses to exactly zero, to don't have any sensitivity to some quark masses we did not include in our calculation. Or for example, switching off QED radiations and all these type of things, just to have a cleaner environment. Most importantly, we switched off hedonization of the event generator, because as I said before, we do not want to be sensitive to anything going on we don't understand. So we just let the event generator give us the partonic result after the parton shower, and then we modeled hedonization by smearing it with this kind of model function, just to be sure that we understand hedonization fully. And then we can run the parton shower with different parameters for the smearing function, with different energies, and most importantly, with different cutoffs. We run this event generator with different cutoffs. We always fit for the peak position of this observable, so we use this rescaled observable here with the mass. Okay, it does not really change anything. And then we can compare this, how the peak is shifting with, when changing the cutoff, with our prediction that I just derived before, which is this equation here, this R evolution. And we can see how well this matches, if the parton shower is really doing exactly as we think it is doing. And we can see here that it really does. So here in the first line, you have results just for massless quarks, so without the top quark. In the second line, you have the results for top quark production. What you see here is these red squares are the results from the Herbig event generator. On this axis, you see the different cutoff values we used. And in this axis, you see the peak position of the distribution. So you see how when you change the cutoff, the peak of this distribution is shifting. And the blue line is our prediction from this R evolution, so this prediction we just derived before. And you see that we have very well agreement that we can really understand how this peak is shifting when we change the cutoff exactly as we predicted. Here, this dashed line actually corresponds to the prediction that you would get if you did not include, if you would not include anything related to changing the mass scheme. So if we just included effects coming from soft variation, but forgot anything about changing the mass scheme, you would get this dashed line, and you see it's not matching. So you can see the effect that you have to include how your mass is shifted by this change in the cutoff. You can also see that here for very low cutoffs, below 1 GeV, the agreement is not so good, which is not a problem, which is not a surprise, because we're still doing perturbative calculations at the cutoff scale. So when you go to very slow cutoffs, at some point this will break down. This is not a surprise. Important thing is that here in the region where it should work for cutoffs larger than 1 GeV, we have very well agreement with the actual parton shower. So now that we identified this mass scheme of the parton shower with these restrictions I mentioned before, we can now try to relate this to different well-known mass schemes. So if you just assume for the moment that this coherent branching mass is the Herbig mass, it's not that simple, but for the moment we just assume this. So the Herbig standard tune uses a cutoff value of 1.25 GeV. So now we can ask, how is this coherent branching mass at this cutoff value related to other mass schemes? For example, we can use the MSR mass, which is one of these short distance masses that is out there on the market. We can use our formula and we can get a result how they are related. We get this result that we have this shift here between the coherent branching mass and the MSR mass, and this uncertainty here is estimated from using different schemes for the strong coupling. Since both the MSR mass and the coherent branching mass are free of infrared renormalons, so this series expansion here is free of infrared renormalons, so one should have very well convergence. And the precision we get here is in principle sufficient for anything going on at the LHC in the future. Just I have to, of course, remind you that we still have this restriction in our setup. It's only valid for boosted tops, it's only valid for top quark production and so on. But for a possible future Eplasi minus collider, you may maybe need higher precision, so you would maybe need one term more here. But otherwise, for the LHC, the precision would already be fine. We can now ask how to relate this mass scheme of coherent branching to the pole mass. So this relation between the pole mass and the MSR mass is known to very high orders, and it has this irreducibly uncertainty that is coming from the pole mass renormalon ambiguity. Here I'm using this value of 250 GeV that was estimated by this group. There's a smaller value from this group. The exact value is not so important for me, so I just use one of them. And now we can use this relation between MSR mass and pole mass to find the relation between pole mass and coherent branching mass. And this is the result, where you see that this uncertainty is mainly dominated by this pole mass renormalon ambiguity. One important thing to notice is that shift between the two masses of around 500 MeV is clearly larger than the pole mass renormalon ambiguity. So because maybe someone could say, okay, if this shift is very small, it's smaller than the pole mass ambiguity, I don't need to care, I can always like sweep it under the rug. But this is not the case. This shift is clearly larger than this pole mass ambiguity, so it's really, it's visible, it's there. You should also notice that the shift of order 500 MeV is of the same order as the current experimental uncertainties. So you should not just ignore this. So it will be really important in the future to study more on these perturbative effects and how we can lift these restrictions to have more reliable results. So, so far we talked about the parton shower, about the perturbative effects, how the parton shower affects this, this mass scheme of the event generator. And we found well agreement between our analytic calculations and the Herbig 7 event generator, but we did not include any effects from hydronization until now. So now the next step is to ask the question, how well does Herbig's hydronization model match the analytic prediction? So that's now another, so that we can study these possible non-perturbative contributions. This is the final goal. So again, we do our study first for this thrust or to jettiness distribution tau, because this we understand very well, and we just start to look at massless quarks. So first we start with a very simple setup that we can understand very well, and then in the future we will go to massive quarks and so on. So the question is, so the parton shower gives you a result, gives you a final state of quarks and gluons, and the distribution looks somehow like this. Then you put it into your hadronization model that transforms these quarks and gluons into physically observable hadrons, and then you get the physical distribution like this. And we want to understand how is this hadronization model of Herwig actually doing this in detail? What can we learn from that? So first, look how is the hadronization modeled in our QCD factorization theorem. As I told you before, for these simple event shapes, you can model it quite well by just taking the partonic distribution, convoluting it with a non-perturbative model function to get the hadronic distribution. So, and as I showed you in the first part of my talk, we now understand how this hadronization function has to be shifted in order to compensate this shift that is introduced when you change your cutoff. So when you change your cutoff, you have to change your hadronization function by shifting it by this way. This is what we understood from the first part of the project. Since this is a simple convolution of this form tau minus tau prime, this just means that every bin in your partonic distribution gets smeared out with this type of model function. It just means like the first bin gets, for example, smeared out with this function, the second bin gets smeared out with this function, the third bin gets smeared out with this function, and so on. And this just means, you see, because this is a function that can be written as tau minus tau prime, this is just always a function that's exactly the same shape, just is shifting more and more and more to the right. This is just a simple consequence of this type of convolution. And now we can ask, how is Herwig doing this hadronization? Because it's doing it in a very different way. The standard hadronization model of the Herwig event generator is called the cluster hadronization model, which is sketched here on the right-hand side of this picture that I shamelessly stole. So the parton shower produces quarks and gluons. What then happens is that all these quarks and gluons are set to their constituent mass values, the masses, and then the final state gluons are forced to split into Q-Q bar pairs. So then you have only Q and Q bar pairs, and then always the two color-connected quarks and antiquarks are combined into what is called a cluster. This is shown here, these gray blobs, with always one quark and antiquark are combined into one cluster. Then these clusters, if they're very heavy, they undergo a fission process. So that means they're doing a 1-to-2 decay. So one cluster decays into two lighter clusters along its string axis, which is shown here. Like a heavy cluster can then split into two lighter clusters. This is repeated until all the clusters are light enough. And then these light clusters are finally decaying isotropically in the rest frame isotropically into hadrons. And then you have these hadrons in the final state. This is like very, very brief and short description how this event generator models hadronization. And then you have different tuning parameters that you can use to tune your model to experimental data that are specifying, for example, constituent masses or how the mass spectrum in this fission process looks like and so on. These are the parameters you have to tune. So this is how hadronization is modeled here, of course, very different. And now we can ask, what is this effectively doing with our thrust distribution, where we know how the hadronization actually is working in an analytic case? So we want to understand how Herwig is doing this in more detail. So we define an effective hadronization function. I call it S hat. So that, again, this S hat tells you how you take your partonic distribution and how you get from your partonic distribution to the final hadronic distribution. This is this S hat function. It's a function of tau and tau prime, so always tau prime for me will be the partonic thrust value and tau will be the hadronic thrust value. So the interpretation of this function is just, it's the probability distribution that an event that has the partonic thrust value before hadronization of tau prime, the probability distribution that then after hadronization it ends up with the value of tau. This is just the meaning of this function as hat. And we want to like extract this function from the Herwig event generator. So the first step is that we want to extract this function as hat, and we want to see if it has the properties that we know from the analytic QCD factorization, if this is really a convolution that can be written in this form. It's not clear in the beginning if it is really like this. And then the second step that we have not done yet, but this is of course the goal in the future, that we want to see how this hadronization function is behaving when we change the cutoff. So the idea is that you change the shower cutoff, then you retune your hadronization model, and then you see what is this hadronization function doing, and are there some effects that could affect the top quark mass scheme, for example. This is the final goal, but we are not there yet. So what did we do? We modified Herwig in such a way that it could give us, at the same time, for each event, the partonic thrust value and the hadronic thrust value, so the thrust value before hadronization and after hadronization, so that we could then fill this into a two-dimensional histogram that looks like this. Here we have the partonic thrust value, and we have the hadronic thrust value, and here we can basically read off this hadronization function as hat. And you see that for larger thrust values, this is exactly this type of function where you see it's always the same shape, it's just always shifting more and more and more to the left. But here for very low thrust values, you can see that something is happening. You can also see this in more detail. So if you look how each bin for a given tau prime, for a given partonic thrust value is smeared out, in the tail, it looks like this. So for example, one bin gets smeared out with this function, the next bin gets smeared out with this function, the next one with this. and so on and so on. And this is exactly this behavior as we saw before. It's always the same shape. It's just shifting more and more to the right. This is exactly a function that can be written in this form. This matches exactly what we saw in the analytic factorization theorem. But if we go to very small thrust values in the peak region, the behavior looks completely different. So you see one, the first bin gets smeared out with this function, the next bin with this and with this. And you see the shape is changing. Actually, they're shifting in the wrong direction. So they're going more and more to the left, if I go high, to the right in the thrust. So it's a strange behavior. So you see that this type of function is clearly not compatible with something like this. So we see that for very small thrust values, the effective hydrogenization function of Herwig does not match the behavior that was predicted by this analytic QCD factorization theorem. Why is this the case? So what we saw until now is that we know that if there are only very few perturbative emissions in the Poisson showers, then these color-connected quarks can be very far apart in phase space, so they can basically go into different directions, and this leads to these clusters of very large environment mass. So the extreme case you can think of is that you have an event where the Parton shower does not produce any additional radiation. You just have the originally light quarks going back to back and nothing else. And then, of course, these two quarks are color connected because there's nothing else that's colored. And then they will be clustered into one cluster that is addressed in the lab frame and has the full mass of the full center of mass energy, such a super heavy cluster. Then this cluster undergoes this fission process. It decays to lighter, lighter, and lighter clusters. But it seems that for these very heavy clusters, this fission process does not produce sufficiently light clusters such that in the Hadrick, because in the Partonic case, you just have a very jet-like event, just two quarks. And it seems that then these clusters that are produced in this fission process are not fast enough so that in the Hadronic case, you do not have such a jet-like event, but something gets a bit more isotropically. And that's why we get this kind of strange hadronization effects here. This is what we saw until now. I have to say, is this a problem? I'm not saying it is, so I don't want that anybody here walks out and then says there was this guy who was telling me that Herwig's hadronization model doesn't work. This is not my point. Hadronization model of Herwig is working very well. It gives you very nice results. Just when we want to directly compare it one-to-one to this analytic factorization properties, we see it's not so easy to relate it one to each other. I'm not even saying, is this a problem? We don't know. If yes, how can we cure it? We don't know. We're working on it. So you see I'm running out of answers. So I really showed you this project until the very point where we are now. So with this, I have to stop, and I come to my conclusions. So what did we achieve? We found that for the angular-ordered Parton shower, this is the Parton shower used in the Herwig event generator, one can derive the perturbative contributions between the generator mass and the pole mass, and they are given by this relation at next to leading order. And this is just, as it's written here, the location of the quark propagator in presence of a shower cut. So this is what we call this coherent branching mass. As I mentioned in the beginning, we still have some restrictions in our setup. So this is, strictly speaking, valid only for boosted top quarks. To go beyond this, we would need Parton shower algorithms that are valid also for slow tops. And we don't have that. We adopted the narrow width approximation, so we did not include any width effects. So to go beyond that, we would need to have Parton showers for unstable tops. We don't have that. We just look at top production. That's why we always looked at this observable of two jettiness, because it's not sensitive to top quark decay. To go beyond that, we would need factorized predictions that are also including top quark decay, and we don't have that. So for all these things, we would need new conceptual developments to lift these restrictions, and we want to work on that in the future. I would also like to mention that these numerical calibrations I mentioned in the beginning are still important for us as a tool as consistency check, because this really gives you a definite number as an answer. And as I showed you in the end of my talk, there's also this ongoing work to better understand the Monte Carlo hydronization models with the eventual goal to maybe find out possible non-perturbative contributions in this relation between the generator mass and pole mass or any other well-defined mass scheme. So thank you for your attention.
So when you said that step number one was to check whether the function was depending on the difference of the tau values, I would have a step number zero, which is checking that the distribution before and after hadronization is just a shift in the tail. And that's something that you can do like in a couple of minutes, right?
The distribution before and after hadronization is what?
One is shifted with respect to the other for one value of Q. If the shape function is depends on the difference, than necessarily to very good approximation in detail before and after hadron. It's a simple shift, and that you can check without having to do this two-dimensional.
In the tail, this is also, you see in the tail. Oh. In the tail, it really has this property, yes. Mm-hmm. So in the tail, this works exactly as is expected from the analytic form.
Yeah. And something else, this behavior for very low tau prime, could you blame that in some anomalous dimension of the power correction, like hadron mass effect?
No, as I said, we see that somehow these very heavy clusters that are produced are somehow not fissioned into light enough clusters. This is all we can say in a moment, but yeah, as I said, we're trying to play around with this, what we can do there. We don't have an answer yet.
Is this on?
Yeah.
Can you go back one, two, or three slides? There, 22. So yeah, this is kind of one of your main points, and I'm ashamed I don't know the answer to this question, but the fact that this S hat takes this shift form that you say is a prediction of QCD factorization. Can you remind me how QCD factorization predicts that form for the non-perturbative contributions to the soft function? Or is that something we assume when we write this form that the model there's a model function that convolves with the perturbative part in this way?
I can definitely say that it works very well. If it's really, if you can derive it in a strict way, I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I think that you can know it because you're only, well, you also said that you're only sensitive to the first moment of this model function. And I think all of this is related to this form of this convolution. That all these things are not mm-hmm. working if this is not a convolution like this.
So then is that form is only strictly true in a region of the distribution where the non-perturbative correction is just a shift? It's not, we don't know that it's true for the whole distribution, right?
I'm not really saying that if it has not this form, this is something wrong. Mm-hmm. This is, in the analytic way, distribution, we are using this form of convolution. Herwig is getting good results in some strange different way. This is what I can say. I'm not saying that this is something wrong.
Yeah. I guess QCD would predict that form for the perturbative factorization, but your talk reminded me, even though I've written that down my whole career, that I don't actually know how to prove if that form is true. But, okay.
So you mentioned already a number of restrictions of your current approach. So what about proton-proton to TD bar?
Well, that's another thing that we looked at the plus and minus. So in principle, you can ask if this is valid for proton-proton.
So what would you have to change?
I think that when you're going from plus to minus to proton-proton, it's not such a big problem because the parton shower in the end is always doing the same. What we did here until now is just looking at effects of the parton shower radiating from the original quark. So this is basically the same. So what we started here, I think nothing would change. But of course, in total, you will have some other effects going on with some initial state radiation going somewhere. Might have some effects, yes. We did not study this, but this is strictly speaking only plus and minus, yeah.
But I guess the accuracy of the parton shower would be different from TP to TTR. You can enrich fully next to the log.
Can also be. That's why we started in the beginning, always a plus and minus, because it's clean, we understand it, and then of course we have to somehow lift these restrictions one by one. And this would be, for example, another one, you're right.
Yeah, I just want to mention that, so you're using the parton level Monte Carlo as a proxy for parton level perturbative calculation, and then you're trying to see how far you can take this analogy of convoluting with the shape function and getting a hadron level result. So to me, it's not a big surprise that this is not a simple shift in the very small tau region, because we know the non-perturbative effects for very small tau are order one, right? So they can be described by a simple one moment, and it now it's sensitive to all the higher moments. So
can be that maybe one cannot model it like this. We don't know yet.
It's just a comment that I want to make.
So if there are no more questions, we thank the speaker again.